أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا بالقاسم محمد اللهم صل على وعلى عترته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين توفاهم الملائكة ظالمي أنفسهم قالوا فيما كنتم قالوا كنا مستضعفين في الأرض قالوا ألم تكن أرض الله واسعة فتهاجروا فيها فأولئك مأواهم جهنم وساءت مصيرا صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد for the love of أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد and for the love of Imam al-Asr and for the hastening of his reappearance صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد The verse which I recited today was from Surah An-Nisa, verse number 97. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse, and those whose souls were taken by the angels when they were caused to die, and the angels came to take the souls while they were wronging themselves. They were in the state that they were wronging themselves. They were unjust to themselves. They were sinning. And the angels said, in what state were you in? Fima kuntum. Because as previously they had been Muslims and now they were sinning. And as death came to them, the angels asked them, how comes you are now sinning where you had professed your Islam to Rasulullah? And they answered, kunna mustad'afina fil ardh. We were weakened in the earth. In the land we were weak, we were mustad'afin. And the situation was, the Sha'na Nuzul was that they were those people who had not migrated with the Prophet to Medina. They stayed behind in Mecca and they could not fortify themselves and their faith and their obedience, and they submitted to the society around them, to the Mushrikeen, and their faith had weakened. So they said, "Kunna mustad'afina fil ardh." And the angels said that this is no excuse. قَالُوا أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. That is not the earth spacious and wide for you to migrate to wherever you want to go to. Nobody restricted you to stay in that place, so that you become susceptible and you lose your faith, and your faith becomes weakened. And so this is no excuse for you. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. For them is the fate of hell, and how bad a fate is this. It's not a mere punishment in the barzakh and then entrance into heaven, and it is not an initial punishment. Their abode forever will be in hell, although they may claim to be Muslims and believers in Islam. We discussed, this is a verse that I want to inshallah discuss today, and it follows on from a question that we asked ourselves yesterday. when we were speaking about the people of the Sabbath breakers, they found themselves in a predicament where their work, their line of work, conflicted with their duties. So, and this is a question that we asked ourselves yesterday as well, that what would we do in that situation? What is our obligation and our duty? And for today, I wish to expand the focus and ask the question that it's not about the workplace, but the environment and the society in which we live in. What kind of effect does that have on us? Does it weaken our faith? Does it not weaken our faith? Does it cause us to commit sins? Does it cause us to become disobedient servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is the month of Ramadan, and we are expected to look within ourselves and our environment around ourselves and see what obstacles there are in our spiritual progression and our spiritual journey in this holy month. And we have to identify those obstacles, those barriers, those hurdles, and we have to think about how to remove them and how to pass them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us that self-disciplining process, because the main obstacle that we have in many of our sins is the desires that we have. Our own desires, our worldly and carnal desires, and Allah gives us that practice in fighting those desires through the fast and through the excessive worship that we undertake during this holy month. And so this month is about finding those hurdles and removing them, extinguishing them, so that we can clear our path to spiritual progression and improvement. And so therefore we discuss today the obstacles that we see around us. And we discuss today what we call at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra. It's related to the verse that I recited. And ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra, I'm not sure many of you are aware of this phrase. In the words of the Ma'sumeen alayhim as-salatu was-salam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When they count the seven major sins, the seven sins which are termed as the al-kaba'ir, gunaha'i kabira, whenever I read a hadith in Usul al-Kafi or any such books, and the Imam listed the major sins, there may be some discrepancies where this isn't mentioned there and that is mentioned there but not here. But there is one thing that is mentioned in all of those ahadith, and that is at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra. It is one of the seven major sins, alongside killing a mu'min. And this sin is something, and all the kaba'ir, all the major sins, are something that we have to be serious about. It's something that affects us. What is the importance of all the kabair, all of the major sins? We have to understand what is the difference between a minor sin and a major sin. The major sin, one difference, I don't want to get into this topic about the categorization of the sins and the differences between them. But one difference is that the minor sin can be forgiven more easily through our repentance and seeking of forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through our good deeds. Through our good deeds we can wipe out our bad deeds. But with our major sins, it requires a greater effort for us, if we have committed such a sin, to remove that sin and to be forgiven for that sin. We have to change our attitude and our outlook, because all of these sins amount to something which is disbelief or akin to shirk. And even in one of the ahadith of the Ma'sumeen alayhim as-salatu was-salam, when the Imam lists all the major sins, at the end he takes at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra and says, huwa shirk. This is shirk. And inshallah, we will see how that is shirk and how that is disbelief. But all of these sins are akin to something which is associated with disbelief. And this is something living, particularly for us living in the West, in a society which does not value Islamic morality and Islamic ethics, and we see certain elements in our society which are a continuous incitement towards sinning. Wherever we go, we will find that there is sinning happening, and it's a difficult environment for us to live in. But inshallah, I will not try and get everybody to migrate back to the Pakistan or India, wherever we came from. Inshallah, we'll look at solutions to our problems. But we have to understand at ta'arru ba'd al-hijra what it means first. And ta'arrub, it is comprised of two words, ta'arrub and hijra. Hijra, we know what that means. It means traveling somewhere, migrating somewhere. And what the dictionary definition of ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra is, that moving from one place where one's iman and one's obedience and his observance of the laws of Islam is in place and intact, and he moves from that place and travels to another place where his faith, his belief, and his observance of the religious laws are affected negatively. They are detrimentally affected by that society in which he's traveling to. And this is what ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra means. Initially, in early Islamic society, the people were divided into two groups, generally speaking, in from one aspect. There were those people who lived in the towns, and they had access to a variety of people and the students of the Prophet and the Prophet himself, and they could learn about Islam. They could seek knowledge and they could seek enlightenment from the Holy Quran and the Prophet. And that on one hand. And on the other hand, you had the people living in the deserts, the Bedouins. And they were called the A'rab. And the A'rab were put in a separate category. And the city dwellers and the town dwellers didn't really like them so much. Mainly because of their lack of knowledge and their preference for the lack of knowledge. They like to remain in their ignorance. And for their lack of observance of the laws of Islam. And we have the verse in the Holy Quran where the A'rab, they call the A'rab, the Bedouins came to the Prophet and they professed faith. They said, Amanna, and Rasulullah said, don't say Amanna, but say Aslamna. We have become Muslims, we have submitted to the religion of Islam, but faith hasn't yet entered into their hearts. And of course, it's not all the A'rab, but it's a generalization of the majority of those people. And in another verse of the Holy Quran, the A'rab are condemned in a very strong way by it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, الْأَعْرَابُ أَشَدُّ كُفْرًا وَنِفَاقًا وَأَجْدَرُ أَلَّا يَعْمَلُوا حُدُودَ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى رَسُولِهِ. That the A'rab, the Bedouins, they had such a mentality, generally speaking, that they were severe and strong in their kufr. Or when they become professed Islam, when they became Muslims, they were strong in their nifaq, in their hypocrisy. وَأَجْدَرُوا أَلَّا يَعْمَلُوا حَدُودَ اللَّهِ حَدُودَ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ. And they were more inclined, and their disposition was such that they were inclined towards disobedience to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the words of the Quran, that a whole group of people are being condemned in this way. And this is where the word ta'arrub comes from. People who came to the Prophet from the Aryah, from the countryside and from the deserts, they were told that you shouldn't go back to your Bedouin life. You shouldn't go back to your nomadic life and to your people, because you will lose that faith that you have just gotten. you'll lose the knowledge. You will slowly start to acclimate yourself and adapt yourself to your environment. And we do that. In the environment in which we live in, we will slowly, gradually, or all of a sudden, whatever the case may be, we will acclimate somewhat to that society, to that community. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Muhammad, he said, Al-mar'u ala dini khalilihi wa qarinihi, that a person is on the religion of his friend and his companion. Well, if I hang around with somebody who is of a different madhab, who is of a different religion, doesn't mean that I have become, converted to that religion, to that way of life. It doesn't necessarily mean that, but the essence of this saying is that we take on, we are affected by those around us. That if they have a certain philosophy, they have a certain way of life, we will be affected by them. So we should be careful about who we sit with, who we talk with, and who we are affected by. And this is not a blanket, inshallah we will see, this is not a blanket rule. At-ta'arru ba'd al-hijra is with a condition, of course, that you will lose that faith. Or you have a suspicion, you have an expectation that you will lose faith if you go back to the Bedouin life. But there was those companions who were strong in faith and they went back to do tabligh. And rather than being affected by them, they are the ones doing the tabligh and affecting and teaching the people back home when they were, where they came from. So it is not a blanket law as such, but it's something that we need to consider, look at ourselves, assess ourselves, that if we were in a Muslim country or in a country which has a Muslim or Islamic environment versus us living in these lands where we are a minority here and we are surrounded by variety types of sins and vices, would we be better off there or here? Now that we are here, how can we defend ourselves? How can we keep ourselves from being affected from those evils and vices around us, the evils of kufr and nifaq? This is the next stage, that we are here now, and it is for us to decide, really, looking at ourselves, and not just for ourselves, for our family, because the family that we are bringing up here, the children that we are bringing up here, we are responsible for them. If we are careless about our religion and we end up having our children who are not on the right path, those children you are also sending off to the wrong path, as well as yourself, but those children, their sins will be also on your shoulder. You will also have to bear that liability and that responsibility, and the punishment that will come from that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا, that save yourselves, but not just yourselves, but also your families from the fire of hell. So we have that responsibility, not for ourselves, not just for ourselves, but for our families as well, that we have to take care of the iman of our family. They are our sadaqa jariya. Do we want our families to forget Islam? Do we want our families to forget faith and to become irreligious and unobserving of the laws of Islam? This is our decision to make. We are the elders, and the children will complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment and say that our parents led us to this path. It is our parents who have led us to kufr and to disobedience and to sinning. So the responsibility lies with us. And as I said, now that we are here, we need not return back to the lands of Islam and to the lands of Muslims, because there are many vices there as well. Let's face it, if you go in India, Pakistan, in the Middle East, there are many evils and vices there as well. But comparing those areas to these areas, there one can argue that living there would be more safe and more convenient for one's faith and for one's belief. That one can at least, he can wear a libas which is something which is Islamic. And for a woman, she can wear hijab without being tortured, without being mocked, without being segregated. And there we hear the adhans, the prayers are conducted, and it's an Islamic environment, particularly if you go to a country which is populated mainly by the Shias of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam, in the days of Ashura, in the days of Muharram, and in the days of Ramadan, and all the days of the wafas and the munasabat of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam, we have that environment around us, where an environment full of love for the Qur'an, for the Holy Prophet, and for the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wassalam. So obviously it's very clear that such environments are better for us. But how can we save ourselves here while we are here? We have set our roots here and our children are studying here. How do we protect our children when they go out to the schools and to the parks and to wherever they go to, and they pick up various habits which are un-Islamic, and they pick up certain thoughts and philosophies which go against Islam? How do we counter that? Because it will start in the home. It will start with the family and with the parents. And the parents have that responsibility. And so how do we go about doing that? And there are several points I'd like to mention, several steps that we can take in order to counter those things, those effects from the outside world, from outside the home, which are detrimental to our faith and to our deen. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد. Before I move on to those steps, those detrimental effects, those negative effects towards our iman and to our faith and our belief are of two types. The first type is when they affect our aqaid, when they affect the usul al-deen, when we are affected by them in the way that, for example, we start doubting something, an element of Islam. We start doubting Tawheed. And there are situations, unfortunately, where Muslims, they've grown up here, the youths have grown up here, but they start doubting various things. They start doubting the wilaya of the Ahlul Bayt. They start doubting the necessity of dhikr Ahlul Bayt and the fadail of Ahlul Bayt, and mourning the days of their mourning, and being happy on the occasions of their happiness. They start doubting that, and they fall into, they start joining other madhahib, which are against the walaya of the Ahlul Bayt. Or they start doubting about the Qur'an, they start doubting about Rasulullah, due to all these insinuations and these philosophies that are thrown around in this community. We should be guarded against those, inshallah, with knowledge and wisdom. Because we don't have any lack of that. It's for us to learn about these things and to counter those things, inshallah, which we'll get to. So these things affect our faith, our aqaid, our core beliefs. They affect our tawheed, our belief in tawheed, in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's some who become Christians here. There are some who tend towards atheism here, and they become mulhideen. This is something that we have to be careful about in this society, that we don't open that path up toward for our youth and for our children. This is one type, and the other type of ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra is that if we are affected in terms of our obedience, we accept Allah as our God, and that the Qur'an is a message of God, and Rasulullah is His messenger, and we accept that the Ahlul Bayt are the Khulafa and the Aimmah of the community of the Muslims. But when it comes to practically applying the laws of Islam, that's where we fall and we slip. We know that prayers are wajib, but we go to a school where it's difficult to pray, or we go to a certain workplace, we work there and it's difficult to pray, so we slowly remove ourselves from our commitment to prayer. through that pressure and through being more self-conscious about what people think about me, people and fasting and the clothing that you wear and the general attitude that one takes, and it is all affected through society, the society in which we live, and it will take us away from the obedience towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We become disobedient, we start committing sins. And this can take over many years. It could be gradual such that we cannot notice it. Slowly, gradually, we start being susceptible and start becoming disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes it could be sudden, of course. For example, let's do... give an example. Let's say if there's a person who he works at a particular place in an office, and in that office they have the Christmas parties or the birthday parties or the colleagues there, and they have a drink of alcohol there. In the beginning, a person will say, who's newly arrived there and he's religious, he says that, you know, I can't drink, and they'll respect that. But as time will pass, he will slowly, in the beginning he probably won't attend such gatherings. And then slowly, through pressure from his colleagues, he will start attending, but he won't drink. He said, I won't drink the alcohol, but I'll have a glass of water instead, or something else. But then slowly he will start, gradually start taking, okay, what's the harm if I take a sip of alcohol? And the people around him will not be the kafir, they'll be the Muslims who have already become the sinners in this respect, in terms of at-ta'arru ba'd al-hijra. They've already lost their faith in their deen. And they're the ones who then say, drink with us. You're in the United Kingdom now, you're free. We can drink alcohol as much as you want, and there's no one to stop us. This is the kind of pressures that people face in this country and in these parts of the world. And slowly, gradually, a person can become susceptible to that. And once you take a sip of alcohol, as we said, you know, in the story of the Sabbath, one person started fishing on the day of Sabbath, and then it started spreading, and then it became... before it was a loophole, and then it became something very open. They're fishing openly on the day of Sabbath, because they entered a false sense of security and comfort. And this is what happens. Slowly, gradually, you become adapted, and change yourself to the color of your environment. And this goes back to the saying of Rasulullah that al-mar'u 'ala dini khalilihi, he is on the religion of his companions, he's on the religion of his society. And this is what can happen, unfortunately. And it has happened in our communities, in the Shias and the Muslim communities living in the West. So you got these types. It's not just about faith, it's about our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what are the steps that we can take to ensure that our household remain away from such vices and we counter it? Because we have an uphill task. It's easier to take care of our family and ourselves in Muslim countries, but it's more difficult here. So we have to go out of our way, and we have to go the extra yard here to do as much as we can. And it will take an effort, but this is the consequences of us living here. We made the choice of living here, so we have to deal with the situation now. No one told us to live here, but if we die here, and we have molded ourselves with the society of kufr, then the angel will come to us and say that, you know, we'll have our excuses, but our excuses won't hold up in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we had the choice, we could travel. And Allah will support us in our travels. Allah will give us, as I said, as I cited in the verse of the Holy Quran, Allah will give us the rizq from sources that we could not even imagine. And provided that we have trust and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we have chosen to live here. And once we made our decision, we have greater responsibilities that lie on our shoulders. The first thing that I would say and I'd mention, which according to, you know, what the scholars have advised the people, is that we have religious centers here. We have the Masajid, the Husayniyas, and the Imam Bargaz. And we have these centers for a purpose, that the Masjid reminds us of Allah, and the Husayniyas and Imam Bargaz remind us and give us that attachment to the Ahlul Bayt, alayhimu salatu wassalam. We need to attend these religious gatherings. We need to attend them, if not for anything else, but for our children. That if they remain attached here and they come and go here, and it becomes their place to go to for whether it is to play games or meet their friends and to socialize, as well as to worship and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for dhikr Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam, it is absolutely necessary that we attend these centers. We can slowly start receding from attending. For example, if we start attending in the beginning, that's fine, we attend. But slowly we start thinking that, you know, I've come home from work, it's tiring, I'm tired now and I need to rest and I can't go. So, you know, you tell your wives and your kids to go. You go, I'll stay at home, I'm tired. And then slowly the family will start saying that, listen, if you're not going, we're also tired. We also go to school. We also do the house chores. We're tired as well. And slowly you fall into that pit where you have, you're going to start keeping away from the religious centers, which will keep you on the right track. Where you recite the Quran, where you recite the du'as, and you recite and you hear the, listen to these lectures of the ulama, and you can ask the questions to the ulama, and you have that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where you learn about Islam. If not anything, even if it is ritualistic, at least it's a link there, back to your roots, the Islamic roots that we must hold on to. And not only that, let us go for a further step. Not only should we attend, we should be active members of the community. We should take part in the activities of the community. And the activities should be continuous, to keep the youth involved, to keep the elders involved, to keep the senior citizens involved, continuously throughout the year. The majalis and the lectures and the programs are not just for Muharram and Shahr Ramadan and Safar. It is for throughout the year, and we need to, inshallah, alhamdulillah, this community is very active, I've noticed, and may it remain active and keep the youth and all members of the community away from the vices and the evils of society around us. Now, I say the vices and the evils about the community around us, it doesn't mean that we start hating them and keep away from them completely, and Islam teaches us that we live with them, we work with them, we study with them, they are our neighbors. We deal with them on a daily basis, and we have to show the proper etiquette and akhlaq, the akhlaq that Islam has taught us in regards to whether we are dealing with our Muslim brothers or whether we're dealing with our brothers in humanity. We have to deal with them in a respectful way. They have their views, we have our views, but the one thing that we cannot allow them to do to us is affect us negatively. We can't allow them to change our religion because of them, change our faith and to compromise our faith. And some people may become very self-conscious about these things. But I've noticed, having studied here and worked here prior to going to the Hawza, I've noticed that people respect integrity and commitment to the religion. And it is not a source of shame for us. It should be a source of pride for us that we pray 5 times a day, and that we fast, and that we observe the hijab, whether it is for the males or the females. We observe modest, decent clothing. These are things which we should be proud of, and we should not try to hide. We say, this is our religion, and this is what we will follow, and we will live in with cordial relationships with yourselves, and we will live in harmony as long as you don't try to ban things for us and create difficulties for us. We should live with such pride here. And this is the first step. The religious centers, they should become populated. People should come here. People should... Yes, we are tired when we come back from work. But the calamity and the difficulties that you will go through in the Day of Judgment, when you'll be asked about what you did with your life and with your children's life, in causing it to go down the gutter, because you have left your religion and you have left the teachings of Islam, this is the markaz. We call these Islamic centers because these are the pivots and the central places that we go to. This is the center of our lives. This is the center where we obtain the knowledge of Islam and the teachings of Islam and the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. So we must ensure that we have this relationship with the religious centers and the mosques. And we are active members. We are involved in all the activities of education and social gatherings. And as long as, of course, these activities should be within the remits and the boundaries of the laws of Islam. In some centers, they have these activities, but it's sometimes very dubious in terms of whether these gatherings are lawful or not. So if you have these activities, it is important to ensure that they are lawful and halal. The second thing which we can use in order to stay on the right path and keep our families on the right path is having a relationship with the ulama, with the pious, rightful ulama who are learned on the traditional line of the Hawza. They are our teachers and our guides. They are our actual physical link towards the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. It is for no trivial reason that the Ma'sumeen said, Al-Nadru ala wajhi al-alim ibadah. Looking at the face of the alim is ibadah. Why? Because if you're looking at him, it'll take you towards God. That is why we call our maraja ayatullah. Because they are the signs of God. You look at them and their piety and their obedience and their servitude towards Allah and their sacrifice. They sacrifice their whole life to teach us how to do taharat and how to pray and so on and so forth. These are the signs of God. Everything can be the sign of God, but these are in particular the signs of God that if we look at them, they will remind us of our duties and obligations towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we many rawayats that exhort us towards sitting with the ulama, learning from the ulama. There are rawayats from Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, about the reward for sitting with the alim. There's one rawayah from one of the ma'sumeen which says that sitting with the ulama, sitting with an alim, is better than 1,000 years of worship. Why is that so? It is because somebody who doesn't sit with the alim, who doesn't have that habit to learn from him, his ibadah is without knowledge. So when somebody is sitting with an alim, learning from him, asking questions, and educating himself about Islam, his level of worship will be that much greater in terms of its value. And therefore, the sitting with an alim is highly rewarded in this respect. It's better than 1,000 years of worship without sitting with an alim, without and remaining ignorant and without that knowledge. So we need to have a relationship with the ulama. The third thing that we must do to ensure the safety of our children is to have our madrasas running adequately and having our children go to those madrasas. In every community there must be a madrasa for the children, whether it is on a weekly basis or a daily basis, according to the means. We must do as much as we can. And the teachers must be fully equipped to be able to deal with the issues that the children bring up. When the children bring up various issues about what they face, the teachers need to be able to deal with that. They need to be educated. And the parents must send their children to the madrasas. You may live in a faraway city, but you need to take the extra effort, because your children, life, education starts at home. That's right. The education must be at home as well. But sometimes it's the habit of many communities. We see that the children of the ulama, even the children of the ulama, they go and study with other ulama. Because maybe the relationship between the parents and the children is more cordial, more, you know, less official. But if there's a teacher there, if there's a system there, if there's a syllabus there, if there's examination, and there's other children who are studying, this will be more beneficial for the children. So apart from the education that is happening in the home, which must happen in the home, in the home they should be the recitation of the Holy Quran, they should be the recitation of the du'as. Let's say you cannot attend the Thursday nights, but recite with your children Du'a Kumail at home. Recite the Quran at home, teach your children. If there's a daily recitation of the Holy Quran on the part of the parents, the children will pick these things up. They're like sponges, they will pick these habits up. They will pick that love up for Islam. There's a rawayah from the Ma'sumeen alayhi salatu wa salam that just as we see the stars in the sky, the beautiful stars in the sky, the same way the people of the heavens, the angels of the heavens will look down upon the earth and see those houses twinkling beautifully like the stars of the sky, they're the houses in which the Quran is recited. So make our houses in which the Quran is recited, where the dhikr of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wa salam is done and recited. Recite on a weekly basis at least, recite Hadith-i Kisa, dhikr Ahlul Bayt. Allow that nur and that love for the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wa salam to flourish in our homes. This is the fourth step that we have to take in educating, rather the third step. The fourth step is having our children stick to our roots, our cultural roots. The Maraji and the scholars have emphasized that for us living in the West, that one of the main pieces of advice that they give us is allow them to and teach them to teach them your languages. Teach them Gujarati or Urdu or Hindi, those languages where you came from. Because those cultures and those languages, if all else fails, if a person has an identity crisis or some other issue, that's one link that he has towards his roots, his Islamic roots, his Muslim roots. So if a person knows Urdu, he can go back to those roots. If a person knows Gujarati, he can go back to that roots. And it may be something cultural, it may be something worldly, but it is a link that a person has towards his religion, towards his ancestral religion. I say ancestral, but of course it has to come through research, individual research and understanding. And the final step that we can take, and I feel is very important, and many people complain that the ulama cannot communicate with the youths of today. They cannot communicate with the youths and the people who are growing up here or raised here in these societies, because haven't undergone the same tribulations here and the same situations here. They haven't grown up in the same circumstances. But what I say to the community is that allow your children to become the ulama of the future. We are all obsessed in terms of enabling our children's education in terms of the worldly jobs and worldly future. But for the future of our community here, we need to make a worldly sacrifice. But I wouldn't call it a worldly sacrifice, because this sacrifice ensures and guarantees the dunya and the akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that we are all given our share of rizq. But the condition for us obtaining that rizq is for us to exert an effort and go out and earn it. if you sit at home, we will not gain our share of rizq. But there's one exception, the student of Islam, talibul ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed that for him. As long as he doesn't get involved in the worldly things, the talibul ilm and the future scholar, as long as he remains on course and pious and mukhlis in his learning, the dunya is guaranteed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an exception that Allah has made. If you look, there's many rawayat which tell us this. And the lies of the ulama, Shahid al-Thani wrote in his book, Munyatul Murid, he said that his own life, he guarantees this. Allah guarantees this, but he also guarantees it because this is what he's seen in his life. He never ran after money, but what happened is that rizq followed him wherever he went. This, inshallah, if you send your children to the Hawza, and if you motivate them, and if they have the desire to study Islam, don't stop them. Allow them to go there. Yes, they won't become rich, they won't become doctors or lawyers, but they will be guides for the community. Guides that this community, the community of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhimu salatu wasalam, desperately need. We need these scholars of the future, and we need to make a sacrifice in this sense. And we need to sacrifice our desires, the desires that we are sacrificing. That yes, we won't see our children living in great luxury. We may do so even. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed the scholars with much rizq as well. But this is not, this shouldn't be of our concern. Our concern is as long as our children are on the right path, that is fine by us. Allah will give us our rizq. Allah is the provider for us. With that, I end today's lecture. Inshallah, may Allah give us safety from the evils and vices from within us, from shaitan and from the societies that we live in. May He give us the strength to fight against those evils and to be proud of our religion and stand firm on our religion. And may Allah give us the strength to and the tawfiq to allow our children to remain on this path. May Allah give us understanding of how to do so and the means to do so. May Allah bless the communities in the West who, despite the society, despite the many attacks on Islam, despite the attacks from many quarters, from within Islam and from outside of Islam, against the teachings of Islam, against the Quran, calling it decadent, calling it a set of teachings of terrorism and the like. May we stand firm against them, and may Allah bless this community that despite all of these attacks, that we do remain firm, and that we do hold these gatherings in these societies, and we work together in these gatherings. May Allah accept our amal of this holy month of Ramadan. Less and fewer days remain in this holy month of Ramadan. Inshallah, may Allah give us a tawfiq to make them count. If we have had any shortcomings in the previous days in the nights of Qadr, may He give us a tawfiq to make up for those shortcomings and to seek the forgiveness and to obtain us the repentance and forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطاهرين الله